Good evening and welcome to this forum for the City of the Village of Clarkston election. Today is September 17, 2015. This forum will feature those candidates who have filed for the Clarkston City Council. There are four candidates for two-year positions, two candidates for 1 2-year term. Sponsor of this forum is the League of Women Voters Oakland area. I am Jerry Burden, member of the League of Women Voters. I'm not a resident of the City of Clarkston. The League of Women Voters is a trusted, national, nonpartisan political organization. Our members do the hands-on work to safeguard democracy. While we never endorse a candidate, we are directly involved in shaping the important issues that keeps our community strong. As a League of Women Voters member, I have the opportunity to contribute in a leadership role such as this that has great impact on local, state, and even national issues. If you're interested in learning how you can become a member, I would encourage you to pick up some of the literature on the table outside the meeting hall tonight, or contact our website at lwvoa.org. The League of Women Voters do not endorse any candidate or political party. Views expressed in this forum are those of the candidates, and the sponsors take no responsibility. The format for this forum has been established by the League of Women Voters. We ask the audience remain silent during the forum. Please turn off all cell phones and electronic devices. We ask that the candidates answer the questions with their views only and not interrupt another candidate. The candidates will be asking questions submitted by the audience and screened for duplication and appropriateness by John McGarry, a League member. Pages will circulate with paper and pencil for your questions. Please turn your questions into the pages, and the format is as follows. All candidates will be given a 1 minute for an opening statement in alphabetical order. Closing statements will be 1 minute in reverse order. Candidates will have 1 minute to answer each question in rotation unless the time is extended by the moderator. All candidates will be allowed equal time to answer all questions. Our timer, Judy Bateman, will indicate when there's 15 seconds and when to stop. The candidates for the two-year term are Michael Castone, Eric Haven, Jason Neese. Also on the ballot, but not here tonight, is David Marsh. Candidates for the one-year term are Alfred A. Avery. Also on the ballot, but not here tonight, is Peggy J. Roth. We will begin our candidate forum with 1 minute opening statement. We will start with Mr. Castone.
Thank you. The League of Women Voters, besides this forum, also asked for written responses that we sent in, which will be on their your website, and I was told about October 1st would be the published date. You didn't start me, did you?
I will stop.
That was a plug for you.
One
of the questions that the League asked was provide a biographical background, who you are, why you're running, and I'm going to read it, because if I don't, I'll be over my minute. My response to that was this: 45-year career in risk management safety, retired. Experience includes the Michigan Municipal League, property liability pool, and workers' compensation fund, which our city participates in. I have a functional understanding of municipal operations and potential loss exposures to human, physical, and financial resources. Quick example, human resource, everything from citizen visitor walking surfaces, employee injury, children playing in parks, and employment practice. Physical use and maintenance of our city-owned equipment. We need to get as much out of each piece of equipment as we can because we don't have a whole bunch of money. And also with regards to buildings and issues dealing with residential and business use. Thank you.
Thank you.
I knew I was.
Wait till I get my Mr. Haven.
Good evening. Thank you, Jerry. My name is Eric Haven. I've lived in the Village of Clarkston for over 40 years, almost 42 years, with my wife and raised our kids here. And now my daughter and son-in-law still live here and two grandchildren. And we love the village of Clarkston. I was thinking on the way over this morning, or this evening, how many people in America get to live in the village. It's an amazing place. And Clarkston is an amazing village and a jewel. And having lived here for as long as I have and enjoyed it, and my wife's parents before us, this truly is home. And as Dorothy said, there's no place like home. And so for that reason, I ran and served 20 years ago when Clarkston became a city. And of late, I have served on the city council. I'm serving there now. And really enjoying being part of the village and really this forum this evening.
Thank you. Mr. Neese.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you for the League of Women Voters for this opportunity. Thanks to all the citizens there that showed up tonight. Appreciate that. I know we're really busy. I actually grew up in the Clarkston area. I moved away, joined the military after high school. I went to Clarkston High School, graduated in 1994. Moved away in the military in many different states, and I've had an opportunity now to come back home. Been here about 2 years now, and I just saw a great opportunity to get involved and try and bridge the kind of the generational groups of people. Clarkston's fortunate to have so many different generations of folks. People have their parents living with them. They have their kids in the area. They have their grandkids in the area. There's so many of those different groups. And I just saw a great opportunity, myself with kids, myself with parents and in-laws in the area, to take this opportunity to help out Clarkston and work with Clarkston and the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Alfred Avery. I've been a resident of Clarkston since 2003. I am married to Kim, who is sitting out in the audience tonight. I have two grown daughters. I'm an attorney. I'm in solo private practice. I'm a member of the Clarkston Rotary Club, have been for the past, since 2008. I'm a past president. I am a current secretary of the Rotary Club. During the time that I was president, I helped to initiate the purchase and replacement of the holiday decorations in town. I was appointed to the council after Mr. Bizio resigned, so I've been on the council since June of this year. I've enjoyed my short couple of months on the council. I decided that I wanted to run and finish off the next year that would have been Mr. Bizio's, because I think we live in and just like Eric said, this is an awesome town. I want to do what I can to make it even a better town.
Thank you. Now is the time for questions, and we will start with Mr. Cascon. Would you support rezoning residential properties R1 or RM to village commercial? Why or why not?
Well, it would certainly depend on the property and what the use was going to be. That's a pretty open question. Our community is going through some serious changes right now. We do have the issues to deal with regards to zoning and historic district use. So the answer is yes, I would welcome rezoning if it fit in the basic principles of our community, our strategic plan, who we are. If it fits, we should always take every issue that comes to council and compare it to our principles, what we stand for, who we are, our charter, our strategic plan, any other law or regulation that we deal with. And every issue that comes to council, including zoning, must be addressed to who we are and what we want to be in the future.
Thank you. Mr. Haven.
In a small community like ours, there's a delicate balance between commercial and residential. That's obvious to us all. I think many of us who live here, probably all of us who live here, value the bedroom community that we have. And that has been, we've seen in other communities, that deteriorate away because of special interests. At the same time, we have a viable commercial district becoming more so. And I remember the days when Clarkston was a destination in the past, historically, when the Clarkston Cafe was a place where people would come from the city of Detroit to drive off to have dinner at the Clarkston Cafe and so on. And with recent improvements and developments, Clarkston has become a destination. And so the delicate balance we have here has to be preserved. And so that's why we have a seated council to do that. And it's a very, very important consideration for our community. Every property that has a potential of shifting one way or the other, that's very, very important.
Thank you. Mr. Neese.
Sure, yeah. No, this is a great question. This is actually one of the questions I talked about in my written responses to the league. And basically, it boils down to this for me. I think the issue we're talking about is progress, and I think that's one of the issues that faces Clarkston. So when we look at just micro issues like parking or something like that, that's really kind of a smaller ancillary issue. The bigger overall issue is really progress. Clarkston is progressing, okay? So how do we handle that progress? How do we handle the growth? So I think there are certainly aspects of changing, looking at some residential going commercial. I also think there could be, quite frankly, maybe there's some commercial that could go residential as well. So I think as looking at the progress and how we're going to plan for the future, nothing should be off the books, absolutely. And anything should be up for discussion.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
The short answer is no. I would not support turning residential into commercial. What makes our town what it is the fact that we have a great residential neighborhood area. If you start to turn residential into commercial, then where does it stop? That's my concern. I think it's important that the character and the quaintness of Clarkston is in its neighborhoods, it's in its residents. It's not in the commercial district. So my answer is really simply no, I would not support it.
Thank you. Next question, we'll start with Mr. Haven. Because I have three on the same subject, I will give you a minute and a half. Do you think there is a parking problem in the village? And if so, how would you solve it? And I have that written several different ways.
I'll bet you do. As I said, I've lived here a long time, and I don't know when Clarkston's never had a parking problem. It's an interesting anomaly because parking is a good news and a bad news story. A parking problem or a congestion problem means that this is a desirable place to be. That's why people want to come here. All right, so that's the good news of it. The bad news of it is that there are times of day when it is very difficult. We do have two bypasses around Clarkston. One of them is in jeopardy right now at Sashabaugh. You know, we all know that. But there's options for people. They don't have to go through Clarkston, but if they choose to go through Clarkston, there's a reason why they do. And so the parking issue and the congestion issue is one we do need to consider. We are in changing times, and I think there's some very, very creative suggestions that have been made to really improve the charm and the attractiveness of Clarkston preserving or enabling flow, you know, through our city. And so it's something the council I know is considering. There is a parking study, you know, under being considered right now. So we're going to try and get some facts and figures and then make some better decisions for next steps as we go down the road. But it's an issue. There's no question about it.
Thank you. Mr. Neese.
Yes, I think Mr. Haven kind of answered you know, with the facts and figures, and I think those are things obviously I'd like to see as well. I think it really depends how you define parking problem. I can come home and park just fine. And I also think if you ask retailers to open their books and look at their revenue figures, I doubt that they're having parking problems, that they're pointing to loss of revenue as parking problems and issues. You know, can you park at 2 in the afternoon? Can you park at 10 in the morning? Can you pretty much park any time during the day except for about an hour and a half in the morning and an hour and a half at night? I think fairly simply you can. You can find that parking. You may have to walk a little bit, but I don't necessarily consider that an issue. So I guess it depends how you define the issue parking problem. I would like to see those facts and figures and see what viewpoint and how we're all defining it before we actually consider if it's a parking problem person.
Thank you, Mr. Avery.
Two issues, really, traffic and parking, and the question is really about parking, but for traffic, I think there is an issue. I live on Holcomb Road. We call it the Holcomb Highway because there's times where it takes us 5 minutes to back out of our driveway to get onto the road. That's a problem. That's something that needs to be addressed. Parking, in my opinion, as we sit here today, I don't think there's a problem right now. Now, if we've got a couple of restaurants that are, sounds like they're going in and they're progressing that way, that's why I think a parking study is in order, so that we can determine the extent with these two new restaurants, or how they're going to affect our parking. Similar to what Jason said, I haven't noticed people parking in areas they shouldn't be parking. I walk around at night, I live right in town like most of you, and I see open spots for the most part. I don't see people parking on people's property, but there isn't, if you have that happening, you call the sheriff and you get these folks towed. But I don't see it as a widespread problem at the moment. But I think a parking study is in order. Let's address the issue, if there is an issue, so we can take care of it.
Thank you. Mr. Cascone.
We've all heard the term thrown out there numerous times, we have a parking problem. I don't know what that is. It's an opinion, subjective conclusion that we have a parking problem. What I would like to do is turn that into an objective conclusion. And one of the things that council just did with the Monday was to vote on getting a legitimate study done on what this parking problem is. I think it happens and will influence your opinion. If Sammy pulls up and pulls right into a spot in front of Rudy's, and Sally pulls right behind him, but there's no spots there. Sammy does not have a parking problem, but Sally does. It's opinions. We must turn this subjective parking problem into an objective thing that we can address.
Thank you. Next question, we'll start with Mr. Neese. We love a historic district, but sometimes the citizens south of Depot Park feel neglected. What would you do to rectify this situation if this is a problem?
Sure, no, that's a great question. And obviously, I think that's why a lot of us love Clarkston, because we do love the historic charm. I'm a big believer in facts and figures and getting information, so I'd like to see what the feeling of neglect is, and then come to a conclusion as how to neglect it, or how to fix that feeling of neglect. One of my big beliefs is, as a leader, is that I believe there's a win-win for everyone. So 99% of the time, there's a win-win. And I believe that sometimes all of us, and we're like that, with many situations, and I'm sure some of you can think of ways that we're all like this, we kind of take the lazy way out, and we don't always find that win-win. But I believe as a leader, it's our job to find that win-win where everyone, because there is a win-win where everyone's going to feel like they got what they wanted and what they need. And as a leader, it's our job to find that win-win.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
I guess it's difficult to answer the question because I'm not sure what the basis of the question is. If it is the historic district, meaning the commercial district, and that it seems like the city council and our meetings are kind of wrapped up in this commercial district and the issues going on in the commercial district, I would agree that there's an inordinate amount of attention paid to the commercial district. If you're talking from a practical standpoint, I would think some people in the historic district would disagree that it's a benefit to be in the historic district, because there's a lot of things that go on, a lot of approvals that you have to get that you don't have to if you're not in the historic district. So I agree that with the commercial district, it gets more attention than it should. I think there should be more attention paid to the residents and to the neighborhoods, to the streets, to the sidewalks, for everybody else. So, yeah.
Thank you. Mr. Cascone.
This and any other issue that comes to the council must be looked at from, again, our principles, our core of who we are and what we want to be. And that issue has to be compared to that and objectively decided of what it is we're going to do. Everyone has opinions and everything is important to everyone if it's in your backyard. But we must stick with our core, our rock, and every issue that comes in front of council must be compared to that rock. And then an objective decision is made.
Thank you, Mr. Haven.
I think the first word of the question was feelings, and that's always a subjective thing. And I'm like Al, I don't know the origin necessarily of the question or what the concerns are by the party who wrote the question. I will say this, though. It relates to connectedness, the connection between citizenry and government. And I use government with a small g in this town because it really is a community. We're all in, we're all neighbors in that respect. And so some, as those seated here, have decided to become more involved, you know, because of their service. But I would say that interaction is critical. And what I've seen of late in our council room on Monday evenings has been a breath of fresh air to me, because there was so long when we sat there talking among ourselves on a given evening. But of late, there's been a lot of dialogue and a lot of input. And I think from the standpoint of understanding feelings and actual concerns, that's the place where things need to be taken care of. And so I'm glad to be part of it.
Thank you. Next question, we will start with Mr. Avery. Sometimes change is healthy and necessary. We have been involved in many lawsuits over the years. If elected, what could you do to keep these at a minimum?
I assume they're speaking of probably the lawsuit that's currently going on regarding the Closed Meeting Act, the Open Meeting Act. So that's, yeah, that's a little Freudian slip there, I suppose. What would I do to help these go away? I think really some of these probably spring from the fact that there's not enough communication between the residents and the city government. I think with more communication both ways, where people feel connected, if they're invested, if they feel like their opinion matters, then I think we're going to have better communication, and I think it'll work better. But that being said, I'm a lawyer. People sue people all the time, whether friends, enemies, it doesn't matter. If they feel like they've been aggrieved, they're going to file a suit, and sometimes it's hard to stop them. But better communication, I think, is the key.
Thank you. Mr. Castrone.
In 45 years of providing risk management services to public and private sector, everyone would ask, can I be sued? The answer is yes. However, if you prepare yourself for that litigation prior to the litigation happening by doing what you need to do to reduce the exposure, to reduce the risk to that potential litigation, you follow attorneys' suggestions, you keep going back to your core issues, and on this particular one, I was not present when Council went into closed session. I was there Monday, and as far as I'm concerned, Mr. Tam presented a perfect argument to support going into closed session at that point in time.
Thank you. Mr. Haven.
Well, we live in a litigious society. We all know that. And certainly the right of any citizen or entity, really, to use the courts to resolve issues. We can't prevent that, but I do think that the one thing that needs to happen is the best possible communication. And I sort of refer back to the comment I made earlier about interactivity and dialogue and discussion, and low-key discussion is very important. The other issue that is involved in lawsuits and litigation is certainly special interests. And one of the platforms or planks, if you will, of my candidacy, if I could be so formal as this, is that I really want to consider the village issues as a whole. And I think that's the way it needs to be considered. Evaluating special interests or the interests of individual parties, but considering them in the context of what's good for the whole.
Thank you, Mr. Nees.
Sure, as the other candidates have established, definitely anyone can sue anyone anytime they desire. I think the key to it, again, is quite frankly sitting down with folks. Again, people are going to enter into lawsuits because they feel either wronged or they're not getting unfairly treated. Somebody else is getting different treatment than they are. Again, I go back to, I believe there's win-wins. For my part of preventing such lawsuits would be sitting down with individuals and getting them across the table from each other and understanding exactly what it is that people do want. I think all too often we make assumptions and we assume that people want certain things, and a lot of times we never even ask the person exactly what it is they want and how can we make this go away.
Thank you. Next question, we will start with Mr. Cascone. Do you think Clarkson should spend $500,000 on a city hall expansion? If not, why not? And are there any alternatives?
We must deal, because our revenue is limited, we must deal with needs, not wants. This may, in fact, be a need. But I have not heard a detailed enough needs analysis to support spending any money. It may be needed. As far as I know, I don't know. Whatever decision comes up must always be objective, and it must always be to our needs, not wants, and it must always be in line with budget constraints. My granddaughter was here. I played a game with her quickly with four coins. I said, if you went to the store and something cost two coins, could you buy it? She said, yes, 5 years old. I said, if you went to the store and it cost six coins and you have four, can you buy it? She said, no. If a five-year-old gets it, we should get it.
Thank you. Mr. Haven.
I appreciate your simple example, Mike. Whenever you talk about $500,000, people's ears perk up, certainly, especially in small buildings like this. It's a big number, there's no question about it. And we've had, the question is somewhat premature in that this is under study and all the alternatives are being looked at thoroughly. The concern of the citizens is certainly well taken, well founded. As I see it, there's a couple of ways of looking at this. One is it's a math model. When you're married and young and you start out, it's probably good to rent, you know, because you don't have a lot of cash, you know. But as you get on in your life, if you want to build some equity, it's often a good thing to buy and to make what would otherwise be profit for someone else go into what you have as equity. So. This issue is yet to be determined. It is premature. The committee has not reported back on all the alternatives and everything, and it will be aired out, trust me. All our laundry will be hung, in this one as we get closer to an answer to the question.
Thank you. Mr. Neese.
Sure. I definitely think there's more to find out. I haven't seen all the information about this, and there's no specific, proposal on the table right now. I will say this, though, and this goes back to kind of my question that I responded to, and that'll be on the league's website, and it goes back to that progress. Clarkson as a community is progressing, and I think this is a great opportunity to figure out how does this fit into that progression, right? So how does this become part of the community? I think we all would love to, have a, town hall that has gilded hallways and statues out front with water coming out of its mouths. I'm sure that'd be great. How does it fit in with where we're looking for Clarkson to go overall and the kind of community we want to be? So I think this is a great opportunity to not look at this in a bubble, but look at it as a community future forecast vision overall.
Thank you, Mr. Avery.
As we sit here today, my understanding is that we have found space at the school, so that has relieved the immediate pressure to find a space for the property that is getting moved out of the Three East Church. If that is sufficient, I think there are higher priorities in the village than to spend 500,000 for sure, maybe even 300,000 is too much for me. My position is that let's spend that money that we're saving, ostensibly saving, from the lease from Three East Church and put it into sidewalks, roads, you know, trees, things that need to be done first. If it's a need, back to need versus want, if it's a need at some point, then obviously we're going to have to address it, and it may hurt a little bit. We may have to spend some money, but as we sit here today, I think the immediate crunch is over, and I'd rather have that money spent on other priorities.
Thank you. Next question, we'll start with Mr. Haven, and I have about six on this subject, so I'm going to try to paraphrase into three different options where you can spend time on each option. And it's, do you believe that there's a disconnect between the council, the administration, and the citizens?
I have 1 minute for this, is that right?
You have 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Oh, 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Wow. All right.
In other words, one is concerned about communicating with the citizens, the other one's communicating the council, and the other one's the administration communicating with either council or citizens.
Well, that's a complex question. Communication has been raised as an issue of late, and it's reflected in the attendance at city council meetings and that sort of thing. There's also the day-to-day that goes on in the village, and I think there, in the minds of many people, there is a disconnect, and I feel badly about that, but I do think that as I've served on this council, there is a tremendous amount of interest on every council member's part. I don't think there's an exception to this rule at all in bridging that gap. And I think there's open ears, open a willingness to understand, you know, what the particular issues are. Again, there are issues the issues that are special interests, you know, that always come before a village or any government entity like that, and there's lobbying. Sometimes there's strong lobbying for a particular position that may or may not be in the best interest of the whole, okay? But my experience has been that both from the council standpoint as well as the city staff, there's a tremendous amount of energy given to trying to be reasonable and letting people vent, if you will, and having having their say. And I don't think any decisions, I think for anyone who's come to council meetings at all in the past, that you feel there's any sort of railroading or anything like that. I think it's a great dialogue, and it can always be improved. There's no question about it. But I really feel like there's a great disposition on the part of both elected officials as well as our staff to be very reasonable. That's my opinion.
Thank you, Mr. Neese.
Sure. Yeah, I think by the very existence of the question, it's believed by a lot of folks that there is some disconnect out there, and there probably is to some degree, to be quite honest. You know, I think the question is, you know, you could go into fault and try to find out whose fault that is, right? And I'm sure there's plenty of fault to go all the way around. You know, I think it boils down to equity theory. So when a group of folks feel they're being unequally treated, you know, whether that's in voices heard or whatnot, there's going to be, the equation doesn't balance out. And there's going to be, whether you want to call it hurt feelings, disconnect, whatever the term might be, it's going to exist. I'm a big believer, as I talked about, I just moved back here to the community in the past 2 years. You know, and I told my wife, you know, I'm not going to be one of those people that sit around and gripe about issues or whatnot unless I'm willing to get involved. And so I definitely think there's takes both sides, right? So citizens have to seek out the information, but on the other hand, council administration needs to also be willing to meet them halfway and figure out ways, right? I get back to the leadership issue. As leadership of council and the administration, it's their job to also figure out what those needs of the community are and how best to suit those needs. they're not going to do it 100% of the way. The person still has to, the citizens still have to reach them a little bit, somewhat. But definitely the onus falls on the council and the administration. And I think there are a lot of things happening that hopefully will bridge that gap and that misunderstanding and the unequal feeling that people have.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
I'll start with the disconnect between the city council and the citizens to the extent that there is. I've only been on the council for a couple of months, but I feel that the members that we have on the council overall are open to communication. They may not have the same opinion or position that you as a citizen may have, but that's okay. I mean, that's part of our democracy. You know, sometimes we disagree on the issues. As long as there's a civil discourse, I don't see a problem with it. Okay? And I'm always, myself, I'm open to communication. You can stop me. I walk my dog every morning and just about every afternoon. If you see me on the street, you can grab me and say, hey, I think this is a problem. What do you think and what can we do about it? And I'd be more than happy to go talk to Carol or the staff and work as a liaison on your behalf. I just recently got appointed to the communication committee. We just met a week ago and we're going to meet this Monday. And we're going to try to set out a framework where we can make the government more accessible to everyone, all the citizens. I think the new website, which is supposed to be up and running in December, will go a long way towards helping that happen. That being said, I also want to say that, you know, the limited interaction that I've had for the last couple of months with Carol and her staff, I think they do a good job. Okay? It's hard to make everybody happy, but I think they're responsive, they listen, but sometimes they can't give you the answer that you want to get. That happens sometimes. If you feel like it's gone beyond that, that they're doing something just to spite you, or you're not getting the communication that you think you deserve, that's when you go to your council, that's when you talk to me, you talk to Eric, you talk to whoever's on the council, and we'll get to the bottom of it.
Thank you. Mr. Cascone.
Thank you. You can hire as many consultants as you want, spend a fortune, and have them come into either your private or public business, and the issue being, how can we do a better job? And I guarantee you, the number one response will be better communication. So save the money, don't do that, because that will be the response. I think the communication starts in-house first. And I'm talking specifically about performance standards for staff. I don't want to sit at council and say, I think they're doing a good job. I want to sit at council and I want the job performance expectations to be discussed with and presented with staff, and then I want to monitor whether those job expectations are in fact being performed. If they are, pat on the back. If they're not, we need to talk more. Al mentioned the communication committee that was just formed, which I've volunteered and missed the first meeting.
We weren't going to tell anybody that, Mike.
The first thing we need to do there is establish what is it? What is this committee supposed to do? What is our purpose? What are our objectives? And I believe the communication has to go both ways also, not only from council, not only from the city hall out, but it should be easy for the citizens to come back to communicate with us. The website is being worked on. Websites are only as good as they are maintained. You can spend a bunch of money on a website, don't maintain it, you've wasted your money. That's again performance expectations of staff.
Thank you. Next question, we'll start with Mr. Neese. What will you do to specifically address pedestrian safety in the village?
Sure. Obviously, one of the things we've talked about is everyone loves Clarkston because it's a pedestrian-friendly community. It can walk to things. That's one of the advantages of living in the village, quite frankly. The fact that you can walk down, get a gallon of milk from Rudy's or whatnot. Along with that, there are definitely pedestrian safety issues. As Al mentioned, we live nearby each other on Holcomb, and vehicles do come along there quite a clip. It is difficult to cross sometimes. It's not really designated as well as it should be. So I think first and foremost, there need to be the proper designations and markings, and make sure all that's maintained properly and appropriately. And then from there on out, we can get into things like signage, you know, potentially speed bumps maybe in some areas or whatnot. But keeping it safe for pedestrians to walk is the key to Clarkson's success in my mind.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
I agree with Jason. We're getting more and more families moving into town, which I think is awesome. I think it's great. It helps with the vitality of the town. That being said, we've got to find a way to slow people down on the roads, you know, besides it being a parking lot, you know, when we've got too much traffic. You know, we've got a sheriff, we've got a contract with the sheriff. They're doing what they can do. You know, maybe it's working with the sheriff a little bit more, trying to get more targeted areas, trying to get them to slow down on Holcomb a little bit more. We don't have stoplights there, we don't have stop signs, so they get revved up going down White Lake when it turns into Holcomb, and they come up over the hill and they're going 40, 45 miles an hour. I agree, we have to slow people down. We've got too many young kids walking, and we have adults walking, riding bikes, and it's dangerous for them, and we've got to do more.
Thank you. Mr. Cascone.
There are always physical things that we can do to help keep our citizens and visitors safe, from sidewalks to crossings. With all that being said, you can never manage human error out of the equation. People are going to do dumb things. People are going to speed. People are going to break the law. You cannot manage that out. One of the things that we have going for us as a community is what's called governmental immunity. We don't want anybody to get hurt, but protecting our financial assets that I mentioned earlier, we do have governmental immunity, which would be eroded only if there was negligence or gross negligence shown that we did not try at least to do the right thing. You cannot manage people's actions.
Thank you. Mr. Haven.
I think by and large, the mechanics are in place in our city. That is obvious because of the law enforcement and so on that we have. However, there's always incidents. The other morning, I was parked by the X muffler shop that will become a garage again across Clarkson Road, and watched a student take that corner. I don't know how fast he was going, but he did a full 180 and ended up in the driveway of the house to the south. As soon as I could get on the highway, I followed that vehicle, suspecting it might be a student, and found that vehicle in the parking lot of the high school. I parked behind it, took a picture of the license plate, and then called 911 and reported the incident. I say that to say this. I think that having all the infrastructure in place is not the total solution. I think the citizens' involvement is critical to successful control and operation. And so I would encourage every citizen, and we do this in our council meetings. We have a time when it's
sorry,
public
yeah.
opinion.
I'm sorry.
Next question, we will start with Mr. Avery. Recently, capital improvements have been made to the park and other areas of the community. Were these capital improvements fit your definition of responsible budgeting?
If we're talking about the Clark Bridge, I would say that it was absolutely a good idea. Bart and Diane donated $100,000 to get this bridge done. If the bridge needed to be replaced, it was going to cost thousands of dollars to get it done. The city did pitch in at the end of the day some money to help it get finished, but it was far less than we would have cost had Bart and Diane not made their generous donation. So I think it's money well spent for the city. I'm trying to think of what other capital improvements we've had in the park per se, but I will say this, that the Depot Park is our jewel in town. People come here from all around to get married. They come here to go to the concerts in the park. It is the face of the village, so I think it is money well invested.
Thank you, Mr. Cascone.
I don't know if they were within budget. I wasn't there at the time. I would hope that they were. I know there were significant donations, particularly the Clark family. I wear my risk manager hat all the time. I'm looking at the most recent park improvement, and I have some very serious concerns of the design and the implementation of that design on that walkway particularly. It is not good. It is a injury accident waiting to happen. I want to revisit that design plan.
Thank you. Mr. Haven.
I think the question was about budgeting. I think this project, if we're again talking about the bridge, in that beautiful little park, it's the second beautiful bridge we have in that park. I don't know how many communities have anything anywhere near like that, like what we have in terms of our infrastructure there. I won't say things are perfect. I think that all the governmental specs and so on have been honored and will be honored in that. There may be some more things that need to be done. I've understood that. I've seen pictures of the slope issues and so on, so I get that. But from the financial standpoint, I am tremendously impressed with this community and the philanthropic generosity of people here, not only in the Clark Bridge, but the previous one that Jenny Schultz was involved in installing. We've, as Al said, we got a beautiful place there, and I know there are many involved in the funding of that, the Wild Ones and the Flint Valley Watershed, as well as the village and the Clark. So it was a collaborative effort, and I think the outcome is gorgeous, frankly, for our village.
Thank you. Next question, we will start with Mr. Cascone. If elected, will you be accessible to the community on a regular basis? I'm sorry, did I miss one?
No, we got one more to go.
No worries.
Already had you checked.
I wasn't privy to the budgeting around the capital improvements in the Depot Park area, but I do want to say this about capital improvements, and Al talked about being a jewel of the community, and I do believe that. And again, I think this fits in a larger, you know, where does Depot Park fit in our plan, right? So if we're looking at these things in singular instances, hey, there's a bridge, we've got to fix it. There's a piece of playground, or whatever it might be. I think we need a more holistic approach to any sort of capital improvement that we're doing in the community. And how does that fit in the grander scheme of everything that we're trying to do? And, you know, we kind of weave a thread, right, in between everything, and there seems to be some consistency, and it seems like we have a plan, right? So that's what I would say about capital improvements. I just think that those are things that should definitely be looked at in detail and do the best possible for the community.
Thank you. Now we'll start with Mr. Castone. If elected, will you be accessible to the community on a regular basis? Will you have time to address constituent needs? Does your outside employment interfere with those needs of the council?
I love being retired. I really, really do. People said you need to keep busy. I'm not having any problem with that. The accessibility started with me long before this election is even going to happen. During the nomination petition process, where you need to get 20 to 40 signatures of registered voters in this community, I didn't go to my friends, all two of them. I handpicked people that I went to. I went to present and past council members. I went to homeowners and renters. I went to business owners and their clients. I went to to people on the historical commission, and I went to people who have had serious issues with the historic commission during the years. I talked to people on the planning commission, and I talked to people who are having issues with the planning. So my accessibility to the citizens of this community started long before I'm going to be on the council.
Thank you. Mr. Haven.
Categorically, yes. I live in the village. I know a lot of people in the village, and I respond to every phone call and comment I get. We talk about it ourselves, what can be done. I interact with Carol, our city manager, and staff as things arise. So I would say, even though there seems to be a lot of communication these days, there can never be too much communication. We need to communicate, okay? And so that's why I'm here. If I didn't believe in communication or being accessible to the citizenry, wouldn't be wise for me to run, you know, or to serve on the city council. I'm absolutely in favor of and available to people for better communication.
Thank you. Mr. Mees.
Yes, absolutely. I am accessible at any time. If you ask my wife, she'd probably say I'm too accessible and make myself too accessible. But that's the way it is, right? When you're out there trying to interact with folks and be in a community and be part of that community, that's one of the advantages of that. Being accessible, meeting people, understanding what people's needs are and wants, and that's how I think you get things done. Also, I obviously do work full-time, but I think that also makes me accessible. And we do have a lot, as Al talked about, younger families moving into the community, and they also are working and doing things. And so it naturally makes sense that I'm accessible at those same times that those folks are as well. So absolutely, I am 100% accessible.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
I am accessible. I'm my own boss, so I set my own schedule. So if you need to meet with me at 9 in the morning, I'll meet with you at 9 in the morning. If it has to be 6 o'clock at night, I'll meet with you at 6 o'clock at night. My email address is aaverylaw@yahoo.com. Email me, by all means. I'm at the city council meetings every 2 weeks. You can talk to me before. You can talk to me after. I'm more than happy to talk to anybody about any city issue at any time. Again, because we talk doesn't mean necessarily that you and I will agree on whatever it is that you want to talk about, but I'm here to listen. I'm here for you, and I want to do what the people who elect me want, ultimately. That's why I'm here, because if I don't, I won't be here long. I'm up for re-election next year. If I win this year, then you can boot me right out the door if you don't think I'm doing what you want to be done in the city council. So that's where I'm accountable.
Thank you. The next question, we'll start with Mr. Haven. With revenue sharing and stable property values, how will you maintain the budget with increased expenses?
Revenue sharing. I'm not sure exactly what that would be.
Well, the state has cut it every year.
You know, we do get some subsidies from the state, and with that we run our village. And again, there's always tightness. We've come through the downturn, obviously. We all felt that, and yet the economy is coming back, and also our taxation is going up some to make it easier to run the village. So I would say that this is a budgetary issue. You always look at how much you have to spend and where the needs are. I think the village was very conservative during the downturn, and built a cash reserve, you know, that is doing us in good stead right now. But it's dwindling. I think that we have to maintain our fund balance, and we've just recently, as a matter of fact, established a percentage which is generous, but certainly in keeping with MML and other standards. So I think we've done a good budgetary job in that regard.
Thank you, Mr. Neese. Nice.
Yeah, I think this is definitely an utmost priority. I think we're a very blessed community. I think if you look around, and you know, I think most of us you know, we love where we live. We've been able to find a community that we live in, that we love, and we enjoy it. And we have a multitude of financial resources at our hands to kind of use. So I think, obviously, keeping in the budget is fiscally responsible and kind of, to be frank, if we aren't keeping in that, I think it'd be a rather embarrassing situation that we find ourselves in, that we should not be placed in at all, given the given resources. So I think budget and budgeting is a top priority. I think what to spend the money on, that's the key, and that's getting out and talking to the community and figuring out what it is exactly the community wants.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
I agree that we have to have a reasonable fund balance. I've not been on the council for only a couple of months, so I'm kind of just getting my feet wet with that. But overall, my philosophy is that I don't like to spend money that we shouldn't need to, or that we don't need to spend. Spend it on the things that need to happen: sidewalks, roads, things that keep the city operating. If I feel like that there's some items that are expenses that are growing, we're going to have to keep an eye on, I'm certainly going to make that known, and that's important. I mean, we're a town of about 800 people. It's not getting any bigger, so we're going to have to keep our expenses in check, no doubt about it.
Thank you. Mr. Cascone.
Well, I don't need to repeat the coin story. I think you got that one. And it's not a joke. It's real. We must do that. I disagree that the property values are beginning to go back up. We're going to get a little better there. With regards to the revenue sharing, I don't know the exact equation of how much we got yesterday and how much we're going to get today. I don't know that. I already mentioned needs versus wants. We must get more for less, even going as far as I mentioned earlier, things as simple as our city-owned equipment, vehicles. We must put a maintenance program in. We need to milk every mile out of every piece of equipment we have, because we probably won't have the money to buy new stuff. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question, we will start with Mr. Neese, and this will be the final question prior to the closing remarks. What one thing do you hope to accomplish during the term of office, if elected?
So I think the one thing that I would like to accomplish if elected, and I think it is, quite frankly, the biggest issue facing the community, and it's how do we handle the success we've had as a community? How do we look out 20, 30, 40 years from now, and we plan for that future? And it's very difficult. I'm not saying it's easy by any means whatsoever. But I think it's key to Clarkston remaining viable. I think it's key to just everything about the community and its place in this area of Oakland County, to be quite honest. The one cool thing I really love about Clarkston is there's 900 some residents, I think, as of the 2013 census. It's so much more, though, and you'll see that this weekend, Taste of Clarkston. You'll see thousands and thousands and tens of thousands and who knows how many folks coming to town. And so even though it's small number-wise, it really affects a larger portion, and I think we can be that in the future.
Thank you. Mr. Avery.
For the next year, if I'm elected, I want to improve the communication between the city council, and the residents. Like I said, I'm on the communication committee. We're rubbing up a new website, and I want to have more interaction between the city and its residents, because you are the city. I mean, the residents are the city, and if there's this perceived communication gap, that doesn't do anybody any good. I mean, the council and the city management is here to work for you. It's your money. You're paying your taxes. You should get your services delivered in a timely manner and as cost effective as possible. I would make sure that we're not spending more than we're bringing in, and then to start turning our focus onto improvements like sidewalks and roads and those sort of things.
Thank you. Mr. Cascone.
First of all, my own effectiveness to serve the community. This is my first rodeo with being elected in a position like this. I bring skills and experience to the council table that possibly don't exist now. But it's not a Lone Ranger. I need to melt those skills and experience with the other folks on the council table so we can be effective. As one thing specifically that I wanted to mention is my own education to become more effective. The Michigan Municipal League offers a 4-weekend course. They call it an academy. And it's for newly elected officials. It's on a weekend, and there's 4 of them. And I promise you, I will complete those 4 academy sections as soon as possible to increase my effectiveness on our council.
Thank you. Mr. Haven.
I think my disposition toward running in our village is, first of all, appreciation of the village we have, and realizing that increased and enhanced dialogue is important. And the expression, it takes a village, really sort of captures it, I think, for Clarkston uniquely and beautifully so. Specifically, as far as my own contributions are concerned, I see a couple of them. One is that I am now the chairman of the Friends of Depot committee from the council at Depot Park. And I think there's some very interesting suggestions been made about things we could do in that park. Again, that's a diamond in our in a setting there in this village, and what a beautiful thing to have. The other is logistics around the village and pedestrian and vehicular traffic to make that smooth and increase and enhance the charm of our village, keeping that under control.
Thank you. That concludes the questions. We will now have the closing remarks in reverse order. We will start with Mr. Avery.
First of all, I want to thank the League of Women Voters for holding this tonight. Obviously, I've been talking about communication with the citizens all night long, so this is an opportunity to get everybody together and talk about the issues, so I welcome that and thank you. I also thank everyone for coming down tonight, and if anyone's watching on the internet, thank you for watching. I wrote down some notes to make sure I didn't get too far off course, because I'm an attorney and I tend to babble on and go in different directions, but the reason that we live in this town, it's because it's a community where we can walk down our streets and we can say hi to our neighbors, and they're the same neighbors that we've been saying hi to for the last, 5, 10, 15, 20 years. You know that these neighbors care about what's about the neighborhoods, and they care about the town, and they want the right things being done. As it relates to me, I believe in finding solutions. I believe in communication. I believe in taking care of your money and making sure it's being spent wisely. And that's all the time I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Neese.
Again, thank you to the league. Thanks, Jerry, for moderating. Thanks to all the citizens who came out, and thank you for all the questions. Great questions. This was my actually first opportunity ever in this kind of forum anywhere. So. Definitely appreciated the questions. One thing I just wanted to leave you with, and that's just kind of going back to my leadership philosophy, and if elected, kind of the way I approach things, I want you to get to know me and my philosophy. I tell my direct reports at work this, I tell everyone this, and I believe it fits in many different aspects of life, whether it's religion, work, whatever it is. And specifically to the community, I look at it in 3 phases. I believe if I put the community first, I put others second, I put myself third, everything works out in the end for everybody. And I tell all my employees that at work, I tell everyone that. Confusing. She's throwing me a...
You have 15 seconds.
Sure. So yes, as I said, again, it doesn't matter what aspect of your life you're in. I think that you can always find those 3 things and those 3 anchors. And when you follow that, I think everything works out for all 3 of those areas. So thank you again, and appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Haven.
I have thoroughly enjoyed this evening. I think this exchange is great. I wish we'd had it earlier, but we're getting it now, and I appreciate the League of Women Voters for doing this. Our Monday evenings at the council, in the council room, to me is a very enjoyable thing as well. I really like people. I like the interaction. I like the smallness of our village. When I watch the national scene, what goes on, I wouldn't want to be there myself. But in being in the local politics, if you will, if there is such a thing here in Clarkston, this is an enjoyable thing for me. So thank you for being my neighbors and friends, and I look forward to many, many moments of interaction with you all in the future.
Thank you. Mr. Casco.
Well, in sales, they're told, ask for the sale. I'm asking you to vote for me. Between tonight, this is a start, and November 3rd, I'm going to do everything I can to earn that vote. And I will honor your vote, but it needs to be earned. But I felt I should at least ask you for it first. I talked earlier about, I said my, I called it my five, which was talking about principle, needs, objectivity, and cooperation. If you've been counting, that's only four. The fifth one is smiling versus smirking. Oh my. We will stop that at council meetings when we make objective decisions and communicate those decisions properly to the citizens that elected us. As Mr. Hank said, there's no crying in baseball, there's no smirking in council meetings.
Thank you. The League of Women Voters would like to thank the audience, the candidates, Independence Television for making this forum possible. We would also like to thank Dr. Thomas Stone for his involvement in every detail. For the volunteers, Arlene Stone, Ann Clifton, Barbara Rush, and Linda Walker, for further nonpartisan information on these candidates, please check the League of Women Voters website, LWVOA. When known, rebroadcast times will be posted on IndependenceTV.com. This forum will then be rebroadcast several times between now and the election on November 3. The League of Women Voters is funded by contributions from concerned businesses and citizens. Our membership is open to men and women over the age of 18. Remember to vote November 3, 2015. Democracy is not a spectator sport. Thank you and good night.
Thank you.
Good job, man. All right.